to be open and to be enlightened, so that we may know what is the hope of your calling, what is the riches of your glory, what is our inheritance as your children, and what is the exceeding greatness of your power toward us who believe, according to the working of your mighty power. Now remember, in this scripture he said, God has put all things under Jesus' feet, and God has given Jesus a name which is above all name. You carry that name. How do you carry that name? When you pray, you say in Jesus' name. You are a duplicate of God himself. Did you get that? You're a duplicate. And we thank you for that, Father, in Jesus' name. Do you receive it? Well, then let's be seated. What we're going to do here, and we're going to remember something. And remember this again and again. What does that say? What does it say? What you think about, you bring about. Is that not true? Yeah. You think about it. You know, this morning, it took me a little longer to get to church. You know what? I was thinking, if I had my little green bug, I would have been here right on time. It would have taken me 5 minutes instead of 7 minutes. That little green bug was good on the road, guys. I tell you. But it's in a resting place now. The girl that bought it smashed it up. It couldn't live without me. You know what I'm saying. But let's get this here. Mark and Matthew, I'm so proud of you guys. I think that is awesome. I've listened to that several times, that particular one that you're showing and other things, and I think that's awesome. That's all volunteer. But the wonderful thing about it, it's men and women. I saw the girls on there, but I just wanted to make sure. And when you think of 12 years old and up, and look at the training you're getting, look at young Matthew. All the training you're getting, and I heard about computers now too a little bit from your dad. You're getting, Mark, can you come up and tell that a little bit? Where's me a microphone? Where is it, hon? Do you want to get it over there? Would you share a little bit? And I don't know, maybe Matthew would like to come up too. Share a little bit of what you're learning. Come on over here, boys, men. What are some of the things that, now you're learning, you're a pilot.
I'm a pilot and flight instructor.
Yeah, and so, you're a...
So we have the most, if people want to learn how to fly, you just need to buy a plane and I'll help you.
Buy a plane next week.
Yeah. So nobody's taking me up on that deal yet. Okay,
you're Tom, okay. Tom.
But the Civil Air Patrol is in the more high-tech world we live in now. We have the airplane we have is all computerized, so we have to do a lot of training to keep up with the airplane. You saw in the video that we have airplanes that are simulated drones to help the Air Force train.
Yeah.
We do intercept missions, so there's a lot more high-tech activities than maybe we would have done back in the 40s or 50s, or even when I started back in the 70s. And now Matthew right now is competing in a Cyber Patriot competition. Cyber security or computer security is a really big thing. You read a lot about hacking, you know, Russian mm-hmm. hacking, Chinese hacking. And the military has large departments now to protect our computer systems, infrastructure. And Matthew is working with a team, and they compete. Every year there's a big competition where teams all across the high school teams, Civil Air Patrol teams, college teams, they compete to provide security to computer systems. So Matthew's been working on different platforms and working on firewalls and network security and those types of things. And that's about as much as I know. He's the expert.
Is there anything you can add to that, Matthew? I'd appreciate it.
We really have to go through the computer to make sure everything is working properly, because when we go into the virtual world, that when it pops, it's a virtual world where viruses are, and we have to get rid of them. So it's a virtual world where they've hacked everything, and we have to make sure it's all secured. So you're like playing the security guard in the game and making sure everything's locked up and you're safe. That's really what the Cyber Patriot is, to make sure everything's safe.
And you do Windows and Linux and
Ubuntu, yep. So we work all kinds of different, how do you say it?
Software
systems.
Whoa. Hello, world. We need this, don't we? Anything else, Mark?
No, like I said already, I think, you know, it doesn't require someone to go into military service. So if a young person joins, a lot of people think that if a 12-year-old joins that they have to go in the military afterwards. And a lot of the, maybe 40% of our cadets do end up joining the military, one service or another, but the other 60% go on to other careers. So they, what they learn in technology, what they learn in leadership can be applied anywhere. It's not just a military base. Even though we're wearing the uniforms and we learn military customs and courtesies, and we are the auxiliary of the Air Force, it doesn't mean there's any commitment long term to any military service.
Okay.
So, and I encourage young people to, you know, if they're, you know, it's one of many great opportunities out there, to just check it out.
Can they take flight instructions?
They can. So as cadets can take flight instruction for primary flight instruction, and for adults, can take, once they're a private pilot, they can take their advanced instruction in the Civil Air Patrol airplanes.
Whoa.
So that is an opportunity. It cuts the cost about in half.
Okay. Does Matthew, is he taking flight instructions? You are.
We started ground school.
Driving.
Haven't started flying yet. So we're doing the ground training part of the flying.
No, so. He's driving a car. You've got your license? No, you've got your temps.
Yeah, next will be an airplane.
Amen. I like that. And how old are you, Matthew? 15 years old, and he's got all this. But look at the discipline it brings in. See that? Like father, like son, and look at the mother. God is so good to us. Thank you, boys. Did anybody have any questions? No? Thank you, sir. Very, very good. I love it. I just see such an honor with it, and it's just good. It's just good. You think? Amen. So, oh boy, we have to get you involved with Keenan and Michael back there, young man, with that computer and all that. But let's do this here. First, I want you to go, and I don't have that scripture up on here, but I want you to go to something that I think is very important. I'm going to speak fast because I'm excited. Debbie, the songs that you had this morning just stir me up, because you're singing the scripture. When we come in and we sing the scripture, you're singing over your seed that you're going to be planting here in at the end. You're singing over your life. So take those songs and know that they're all scripture. And when you sing them, expect to receive what you're singing. Now, some people... There was kids a long time ago. They sang, you know, "This Little Light of Mine." Okay. Then they were saying, "Father Abraham has many sons." And they sang it, and they were amazed how they could memorize the scriptures. So, but that's what David, King David did, and Solomon. Look at the singing. And when you sing something, you're going to a different level in your brain. And you're going to retain it longer, because down the road what is going to happen is you've got all these little, they call them altars in your mind, all these little storage places in your mind, and right now one of them may be just there, but you haven't tapped into it. But different songs will come back to you. Look at us that used to in the world, and we sang songs. Some of them will come back to you. You know, something so dumb, does your chewing gum lose its flavor on the bedpost overnight? If your mom says don't chew it, do you swallow it in spite? Stick it on your bedpost, right? Then you heave it left and right. You know, dumb songs. Peas, 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 eating gooper peas. Goodness, how delicious. See, I could have sang this morning, Debbie. But I'm saying you're going to a higher level. When you go into the Psalms, so much of that is songs. Start singing those things. Okay, got it? I like that. But in Isaiah 26:3, let's look at that about being a duplicate. And I want to look at it in the Amplified. So go to Isaiah 26:3. I'll go a little bit longer, a little bit further. But getting these things into our spirit man is what is so delicious for us. Getting it into our spirit man. You know what? You know what just hit me? Just think. If we take troubled children at the age of 11, 12, 13, and put them into programs like this, do you think that would straighten them out? They used to, when they had problems with kids, 17, 18, was it even younger than that? They went into the military. But the sergeants, the whoever, could kick their butt. That was not a bad thing. That was a good thing. But then we have got to have a proper military. We've got to have the best, just like little Israel. And then we got to work it. We don't set our men up to die. We set them up to have victory. We don't send them to Vietnam to die and then come back and then spit on them. We don't do that. Just think, God just said things are going to change in 2017, starting January 20th. He said, just move aside and watch. And Donald Trump said it himself. Thank you, Father. That was him. Now, in Isaiah 26:3, it says, you will guard him and keep him in perfect peace. What is he talking about? Well, let's look up at the back, up at the top, and I'll go into Song of Rejoicing in Judah, and I'll go into the King James. In that day shall this song be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. Salvation will God appoint. Salvation will God appoint for walls and bulwarks. Now, I'm going to go over, and I am going to read after verse 2. I'm going to read 3, then in the Amplified again. Open ye the gates, that the righteous nation, which keepeth the truth, may enter in. We are the righteous nation, because it says, in God we trust. Now, going over to 3 again, in the Amplified, you will guard him and keep him in perfect and constant peace, who is mine. Who is he guarding? Who is he guarding? He's talking about us. He's talking about us. Peace, whose mind, both its inclinations and its character, is stayed on you. So if we keep our mind, remember, we think about what we think about, we bring about, we can keep our mind stayed on him. This is what he's all going to do for us. No, he said it's already done before the foundations of the world. So if we can keep our mind stayed on something, on this word, it said, is stayed on you, that is a capital U, God, because he commits himself to you, leans on you, and hopes confidently in you. So he wants us to lean on him and be confident in him and keep our mind stayed on him. Keep his mind. How do we keep our mind stayed on him? On the word, on the word, on the word, on the word. Because there is an enemy who is buffeting us, and Paul used that description. He was constantly being buffeted. And what does that mean? Like the waving of a ship on the boat. Was you ever on, Kim and I were on a boat. Don't go there, she goes. And that boat that we went out, fishing boat, you know, that keeps on buffeting. Do me a favor, don't look down at the water. I thought that was a good thing. That wasn't a good thing. And you try to put squib on a hook, and it's already making your stomach roll. You're just hanging over there, just everything is coming out. It's called upchuck constantly, right? Nothing takes care of that. Oh, yes, it does. When you get close to shore again, everything is in order. Just think, when you go out alone, I'm going to use that as an example. You go out alone, you can have all those problems. But when you get closer to him, the shore, get closer to him, everything is going to be all right. So, because he committed himself to you, lean on you. He wants us to lean on him, and our confidence, our hope is in him. So trust in the Lord. Commit yourself to him. Lean on him. Hope confidently in him forever. For the Lord God is an everlasting rock, the rock of ages. Wow. He is the one that we should be leaning on. He is the one that we should be thinking on. But see, what happens is our mind gets off here. Now, again, I'm going to say this here. We get something in our minds, and we get into our emotions. Now, remember we talked about this? And what happens? That can lead us right overboard. And that's what Paul was saying when he was on the ship. He was saying, don't let your mind get the best of you. Keep your mind focused on the Word of God. Keep your mind focused on Jesus. And that's what Paul had to do. That's what Jesus himself had to do. So, again, I'm going to say this. We are a duplicate of God. That's the way he set it up. Now, we've got the law of attraction working in us. Remember that? I'm going to keep it real simple. Everybody has an odor to them, a good or a bad. You go out and you sweat. Some people stink bad when they sweat. But it's just a lot of the junk that we eat and stuff like that sometimes, you know? Now, but people sometimes have that good fragrance when they sweat. Well, look at, let's start shifting our thinking so that our fragrance, when we're sweating, because the devil is kicking us about, we will have a good fragrance. Did you get that? Keep the good fragrance moving out of you, the Word of God. And it says, all men will be drawn onto you. Well, especially your family will be drawn onto you. So we want to shift. So we're a generation who has developed multiple habits. You look at what the world has. What does the world have? Do whatever you want. Take a knee. Where did we see that? Where did we see that? What did Colin do? Kaepernick, what did he do? He took a knee. I say we should send him to another country so he can kneel there if he wants. See, people don't know how good they really have it here, do they? They really don't know. But we have taken God for granted, and we think we can get away with anything. We operate in the curses, but we want the blessings. How do we operate in the curses? In Deuteronomy 28, the first 15 are the blessings, and then you go on to the curses. But how do we operate in the curses? By what comes out of our mouth. What comes out of our mouth, we're operating. Let's go around here, and let's say you and your husband are having a discussion, you and another person are having a discussion, and your mind is so set on the earthly way instead of the spiritual way. Do you know you're going to fight tooth and nail to stay on that earthly? You know that? Do you know people have proven it? All the learning that I've taken in the past about mind work, creative subconscious, subliminally hidden messages, the conscious mind, it all makes sense now. Because how do we operate? Like I said, we will fight tooth and nail to hold on to evil. People will say, well, you know what's wrong, what you're doing. You know, Allie, that's wrong. You know, Dee Dee, Tom, you know that's wrong, don't you? No, it's not. We will stand and we will fight tooth and nail for the devil. Just think, if we shift that paradigm and we fight tooth and nail for God, for the Word of God, do you think we're going to get blessed? You take those blessings and those curses and you say, I choose to operate in the blessings and not in the curses, right? So what do you want to attract? What are we attracting? I want to attract good things. How do you attract favor? By the Word of God that's flowing through you. When you go someplace, you're just naturally going to have favor. I'm going to tell you this again, and it's because of God's Word in me. I get favor everywhere I go. Even when I call someplace, I get favor. Isn't it amazing? Some things I don't. But you know what? I'm like a little bulldog. I don't quit. I keep on. I keep on saying what I want. Again, I say this here. A lot of us women, and we talk about this on Thursday mornings. Boy, you don't want to come up against a woman who's got that strong mind for the Lord. But that's what you guys want. Because she'll shake you up and put you in place. Do you understand that? That's what we need. You know, it says in the Word, he just put this on to me. He said, the woman is the weaker. What does that really mean, guys? Girls, what does that really mean? That means that during her lifetime, she menstruates. Okay? The body is going through something. The body is going through something. So the man is supposed to be serving the woman. How? By taking her through those times and understanding and loving her and lifting her up in praise and worship and helping her. Now, another thing, when a woman has a baby, boy, oh boy, there's things, because now you've had major surgery, but the body is working all the time when a mother is nursing. So what is God talking about? Christ said that the man is supposed to serve the woman as Christ served the church, meaning that she is going to go through things. A man's body does not go through all those things, but a woman's body does. Now, girls, don't get the idea he's supposed to carry you around. Don't get the idea he's supposed to bow down to your feet. Get over that. That's a bunch of crap. No, my husband should do this. Square away, baby. You're supposed to be raising those kids. The mother is supposed to be the major raiser of those kids. So women, this is just from the Lord right now. I feel very heavy. Don't you try to put that job on your husbands and say he should do it. You do it. And if your kids aren't in order, you take those little fingers right back. Now, I'm going to brag on God. I could take our kids anywhere, and they would behave. Kenny Jr. was taught to help Kim and Tracy. I didn't have to worry about getting kids dressed because he had to go to school every day, summer and winter, for the hearing and the learning disability. I had them trained. You got to train your children up in the ways they shall go so that you can have peace, so that you can go out there. But all men will see, meaning every place you go, people will say, look at those wonderful children of yours. But see, God placed it in a woman to raise those children. Now, my husband, you know, and I see this a little in you, Aaron, too. I see this in Tom. I see this in some of you guys. If you guys were home with the kids, it would be a mess. Don't look around, Tom. I know. Whenever I left and I came back, I think a smart bomb hit it. But you see, God put the woman where she wants more things in order. Do you understand that? We have to have things in order. If now, before I left, if stuff wasn't, I left one thing, two things lay on my kitchen table. Even as I was going down the road, that still was on my mind. I like order. That has been placed in the woman. So the man is there to support and love her, but don't you take advantage of a woman, because then you'll talk to me and I'll jerk the slack out of you. I am a strong woman, and you ask my husband. I'm a strong woman, and I could take care of those kids. Dee Dee lived with us a lot, might as well say lived with us. When a lot of other kids lived with us, they towed the mark, but there was love flowing in there all the time. Right? So thank you, Jesus. That was an extra serendipity. Right? Okay, Revelations 21:5. Bring that up, guys. You're just going to flow right with me because I'm going to go through this. Okay. It says in Revelations 21:5 in the New Living Translation, it says, and the one sitting on the throne said, look, I am making everything new. Wow. And then he said to me, write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true. Now, I'm going to go into more stuff, and we're going to talk about the foundation of the world and all this stuff happens, so on and so on. Genesis 1:26 in the New King James, it says, then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the fowl of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Now, he was giving us the authority, us the authority, us the authority. So Hebrews 2:6 says, but one testifieth in a certain place, saying, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care of him? That's man and woman. That is not just male. This is male and female. Why are you mindful of that human being is what God, what they are saying. Why? Well, John 10:10, let's look at what the thief tries to do. He wants to take away who you really are. The thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus Christ said, I have come so you can have life in abundance to the full, the overflow. But what does the devil try to do? What does he try to do? He tries to get your mind off of the Word of God and who you really are, because if he can steal your identity, did anybody, no, don't raise your hand, but you've heard about people that have had their identity stole? Yeah. You know what? They're trying to make it such a fearful thing that you buy this and you buy that, and you go, absolutely not. You put your little hands on your checkbook, you put your little hands on anything, and then you warn the devil. Listen, buddy, you steal anything out of my checkbook, anything of mine, and I'm coming after you, because I found the scripture where it says you got to return to me 7 times. And plead the blood of Jesus. There's so much fear out there. That's what I'm talking about. So much stuff being loosed. And we're buying it up. We're eating this stuff right up. Stop it! I don't need a security system on my home. You know what I need? The Holy Ghost, and he'll take them suckers out. Again, I tell you, when we were at the cottage, when the kids were young, okay? came home. Well, Kenny Jr. went home. He called and he said, we just had the phone up on the cottage. Well, then you didn't have cell phone. We didn't have cell phone. Did you break in the house? No. I was known to break in the house because I had my keys. Did you break in the house? No, no. Well, the house, you know, it's our first house we lived in. And what happened is the latch had been pried open. And the door was hanging open. And you could see that somebody had broken in. Well, go through the house. I didn't have to get worried. You know, I bless God. I had a mink coat. I had really nice jewelry and stuff like that. Money up in the drawer. You know, I like to stash 20s and stuff like that. Nothing was touched. Why? Because I pleaded the blood of Jesus over our home. I put oil over that doorpost, over every doorpost. You do that, the enemy will just get so scared. He just don't know which way to turn. We have the power. The devil was afraid of Jesus. That's why he killed him, but he couldn't keep him dead, could he? Now, he says in verse 11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for his sheep. This is Christ to the church. This as men are to women. They're to give their very life for their wife. I am so blessed. Women, we are blessed in this church to have men that do that. Just think. Jesus put us first. That's why the man puts the wife first. It's just awesome. Is God your father? Is God your father? Is he your father? Okay, so let's look at Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live. Now remember the old man? Remember the old person you were yesterday? The day before? Remember the old person? No, you don't remember who I was. But I remember. But Christ lives in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Whew. I'm a new person. Now, in Galatians 3:26, we are sons and heirs, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. What is that telling me? I'm a duplicate of God. I'm a duplicate of God. Can you duplicate yourselves? Women and men, you can have children. That's duplicating. Well, we're children of God. We're a duplicate. I can tell your kids, if your kids walk in, I can tell your kids they look like you. Now, in Galatians 4:4 says, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. Galatians 4:6 says, and because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. So now, who is in your heart? Who is in your heart? He sent forth God, and he put him right inside of us. Is my parents inside of me? Absolutely. But then when I got born again, I went to a different level. That is my true dad, because my mom and dad are really my brothers and sisters in Christ. Is that true? My kids, Kim is my sister in Christ. Kenny Jr. is my brother in Christ. Isn't that amazing? We're just loaned these children. They're really his. Did he buy you with a price? Does your body belong to you? It says in the Word, it doesn't belong to us, it belongs to him. What are we doing with our body? Just stop and think about it. Listen, I'm looking at me. I got to straighten things out. The way I eat sometimes. When we were making candy the other day, it was just going in. See, we're bought with a price. This doesn't belong to you. This belongs to him. But you don't want to leave this because you need to be here to further the kingdom of God. Galatians 4:7 says, therefore, you are no longer a slave but a son. And if a slave, then an heir of God through Christ Jesus. Now, how do you become a slave? How do you become a slave to the devil? By doing what he tells you to do. I was a slave to the devil when I was a drinker, when I was a smoker. I was a slave. People who do drugs, people who drink, people who smoke, people who swear, people who do the curses are slaves to the devil. Do you see what we're all cleaning up? But God is inside us and he's already forgiven us. But you know, it just cuts off our blessing, but we don't want to be cut off. So everyone has the power of, if you're born again, which you are, every one of you have the right and you have the power and you have the authority to lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. You have the power to speak over somebody. I don't care if they're 1,000 miles away. You can speak over them, and whatever's wrong, you can make it right. Well, it didn't happen right away. You know what? The more faith we get in us, the faster things are going to happen. Right? Yes. So, Mark 1:40. Jesus healed the leper. I thought this was really neat. A man with leprosy came and knelt in front of Jesus, begging to be healed. If you are willing, can you heal me and make me clean? He said, moved with compassion. Does God operate in compassion? Say no. He only operates in love. Compassion can go the opposite of love. I have compassion on that person. I have compassion. That person just killed 20 people. I have passion on him, for him. Don't put him to death. Is that compassion? No. The rule is the rule is the rule is the rule is the rule. You kill somebody, it's not going to be pretty. We understand. Jesus went, and always remember this, and remember a long time ago we studied on that. You look into the invisible, and what is in the invisible? What is in the invisible? Everything we have need of. In Ephesians 1:3, listen to this. And this is the New Living Translation. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realm, because we are united with Christ. When you're united with Christ, and you can walk in all these blessings, why would you not want to? Why would you get mad at somebody that's walking in the blessings and everything seems to be so right in their house? Having a family member that got so ticked at me because everything was going so good in my life, calling me drunk on a Sunday morning. Who do you think you are? A nice house, a nice car, a nice husband, nice kids. Who do you think you are? And she called me collect. It was Dee Dee's mom. And she knows it. She had the same thing. She could have the same thing as I did. But she didn't choose. See, the drinking and the smoking was too important to her. I'm not saying this to tongue lash anybody, but I'm saying, why do we want the blessings, but when we operate in the curses? You see, we have to shift that. We have to turn that diet, we have to turn it around. Right? Turn it, shift our thinking to the Word of God. If you want to be blessed, you operate in the blessings. If you want to be cursed, you operate in the curse. How do we operate in curse? So many times it's our mouth. So, God planned your life before the foundation of the world. In Hebrews 1:10, he also says to the Son, in the beginning, Lord, you laid the foundations of the earth and made the heavens with your hands. Did he do that? He laid the foundation of the earth, because the earth was in heaven in the invisible. In heaven there is no time. On earth there is. We're not supposed to operate in time. We're supposed to operate in the spirit. Don't get into feely touchies. I'm always saying that. Hebrews 1:10. Hebrews 11:10. Abraham was confidently looking forward to a city with eternal foundations, a city designed and built by God. Wow. The foundation of this world. Every blessing that is in that Word of God is right there for us for the taking. Right there. Listen, you put a plate of cookies out there and your kids like those cookies, right? Put those cookies out there and let that kid in that house alone. And don't give him any rules. You come back and that platter of cookies will be gone. Right? I put that out for Kim and Deb. Come home, it'll be gone. Yep. Favorite cookies. Right? You see, that's what God's got in the heaven, in the spirit realm for us. He's got all that awesome stuff for us. Why don't we just go take it? But our mouths are what's screwing us up, folks. That's the thing. You know, we get angry and then we start saying words. And then we say, well, I really didn't mean that. Well, then just say, Lord, I repent. That means I just wiped it out. I just took and blotted that out. or otherwise it's going to block my blessings. You wonder, why aren't things happening, God? Why is everything going so wrong? It's because your mouth is got diarrhea. Right? Isn't that what it is? What I say and what I do is two different things. I speak the word of God, but am I a doer of the word? Am I only a hearer or am I a doer? Do I just hear it or do I? We've got to do the word of God. We've got to speak it, but we've got to do it, and that's what Jesus did. So 1 Peter 1, 3, and 4. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Listen, verse 4. An inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. What is that scripture saying, verse 4? He said, everything in that Bible is reserved for you. Why do you, now I'm going to use this word because God actually uses the word, he, you know, dumb and stupid. He actually uses that when you go back into the Greek. Okay, and I'm not going to go into that. But he says, why would you be so stupid? We don't call people stupid. But God is saying, why would you be stupid to not want this inheritance, this incorruption, undefiled word? Why would you not want what I set before you? Now, I'm going to put a what kind of food do you like? What is your favorite kind of meat? Some people it's a steak. Some people, I don't know, what do you like? Some people it's a venison. Ooh, I like that nice tenderloin, that strip that Eric gives me across the back. It hardly gets cool and we fry that up. Oh, and it's so good. What is your favorite food? God puts it before you, right? Can you only imagine your favorite food? Or how about your favorite dessert? Okay, you got it? Now, you've got that and you're looking at that. It's a whole banquet of food and you're just like, oh, I can't wait to sit down and eat. This is good. It is a six-course meal. Where is that place where it's thousands of dollars and they still go there and you pay, but you have to, it's like three-year reservations you have to make. It's in New York or something. And they get all these course meals. Oh, it's really a thing. When I looked it up that time, I laughed, but they got a little bitty portion so you can sustain it. Now, you look at that meal and you think, look at that meal. That is so good. Right? Have you got the meal? You got the meal. You've got that before you. Kids, teenagers, what would you like? It's just laid right out there. You can just, and you're not going to get full. You're not going to get sick. It's just going to be, ooh. Then I'm going to turn around. Okay, that's your good food. Then I'm going to turn around, and I'm going to give you some fried grasshoppers. And then I'm going to give you those, what do you call those things? Those things out there, those worms, grubs. I'm gonna give you spiders. I'm gonna put snakes out there. I'm gonna cook that up. I'm gonna cook that all up, and I'm gonna put that on another platter. Which one are you gonna focus on? The good stuff. See, God's got all the good stuff out there, but now all the worldly junk that you don't want to eat. Who wants to eat a rat? You don't want to eat a rat. God, you know that what it says in Isaiah, rats and pork are on the same plate. Because you get worms. So now, think about this. Here's this beautiful platter of food. It's just prepared beautiful. But then you got this crap. In fact, we'll put a little of that on there too. Which one would you go and eat? Which one are you focusing on? See, that's what we do. The worldly stuff we look at, but the stuff God has prepared in the heavenlies for us is awesome. So all on 1 Peter 3 and 4 there, it says in verse 4, it says, an inheritance he has for us that is priceless, that is kept in heaven for us. He has a priceless gift for every one of us before the foundation of the world, and it's this word of God. It's this word of God that he has in heaven for you and I. He said it's priceless. It's an inheritance. It's the best thing. It's pure. It's undefiled. Oh, and he says it will never decay. It's waiting for us to come and take it with our mouth. Okay? So let's look at God. God has a plan for each one of our lives. I didn't know plan for my life. You know, it is amazing, but the more that God has set out for your life, do you know the enemy comes more after those people? Isn't that amazing? And you just felt like, I'm a piece of crap. Well, that's the way the devil wants you to feel. And then one day you look up and you're saying, wait a minute, I'm the righteousness of God. I'm the righteousness of God. I'm God's favorite child. Oh, he just thinks I'm the best thing that ever walked. Every one of my tears he catches in the bottle. So every time I get into emotions, I'll turn back and look at what he thinks about me and who I am. Not who the devil or people say I am. I want to say who he says I am. Romans 4:17 says us to do what? This is the Holy Writings. This is the New Life Version. The Holy Writings say, I have made you a father of many nations. This promise is good because of who God is. He makes the dead live again. He speaks, and something is made out of nothing. Isn't that great? See, it's already made in heaven, but we don't see it, do we? Right? But what do we see on the earth? What do we see? Some of us may be just comfortable with what we have. Well, if you're comfortable with your income and you're comfortable with everything you have, then the overflow should go into the kingdom of God instead of saved up, you know, and decaying. So how do we call the rain in? How do we call things in? How does our faith work? Again, that New Life Version, it says that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the good news of the gospel. Is that not true? Let me give that again so I've got it right. So then faith comes to us by hearing the good news. How do you build up your faith in yourself? I was my worst enemy. People that are out on the streets, that are druggies, just think, they don't have a good image of themselves. They don't. They see themselves as garbage. That isn't what God made. But we can turn it around, can't we? Because they'll watch what they see in us. But you'll set the rules. I always saw this here with my kids. I set the rules, and anybody that came to our house, I set the rules. They didn't follow them. You're gone. At the cottage, the same thing. Testimony. The only three of them over 8 years were gone. I was so happy to tell them they couldn't come back, because I was protecting all the rest of those kids. When you think of 40-some kids that stayed over in a weekend for the 4th of July at the cottage, and over those years, I don't know how many of those kids came and thanked me for holding tight to the rules. I had the rules written out. God's got the rules written out. Bad things are going to happen to good people sometimes. But what happens is we can grow stronger through that. He'll never leave us or forsake us. He'll take us through the situation, and you will become stronger. Do you realize that? Oh, he's so good to me. So how do we build up our faith? We build up our faith by hearing the word of God. In Mark 5:28, it says, a woman that was sick for 12 years with a flow of blood, she had suffered much because of having many doctors. Now, doctors can only go so far. We all know that. We like doctors. Don't get me wrong. She had spent all of the money she had. She had received no help, but became worse. She heard about Jesus. She heard about Jesus. I want you to remember that. And went in among the people who were following him. She touched his coat. She said to herself, if I can only touch his coat, I will be healed. I'm going to show you something. When I saw this here, I thought, this is a good thing. You've seen something like this before. What happened when she heard about Jesus? What happened when she heard about Jesus? What happened when she heard about Jesus? The light went on. The light, that's quite bright, isn't it? Well, if you were sleeping and you just woke up, this is really hard on your eyes. Did you ever do that, wake up in your room? Now, think of this here. When you take the word of God, because she said in Mark 5:28, for she said, she kept saying, if I can only touch his garment, if I can only touch his garment, let's bring that alive. Let's bring that alive. Let's get more understanding. How do I do what she did? Man, I've been doing this thing. But just think, you say, when I find the word of God, when I find what it says for healing, when I find what it says for prosperity, when I find what it says to help my children, what I find for my job, what I find, the light's going to go on. The light is going to go on because you just did like she did. You found the word of God. She found the word. She found the word. She found the word. And when she found Jesus, because Jesus is the word, right? He's the word. So she found the word. The light went on. So when you find the promise in the scripture, that's what she found. Because Jesus is the word. And she found him. And she pressed in. So now you find the scripture that you need for your situation. 2-3 scriptures. And once you find it, that light, I'll do that again just a reminder, that light will go on. And you'll say, that is mine. Just with my gloves. Remember something so simple as my gloves? When you find something and you find he's got to restore 7 times. And by the way, I said to the enemy this morning, even when I looked at that old glove, that nice glove, I said, by the way, I want new gloves for that. You stole it for a year from me. I want 7 more pair or more. Can I do that? I found, just like the woman with the issue of blood, I found the promise. Did I? When you find the truth, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. That's Jesus. So she found the Word. So when you find your promise in this Word, you go after it. Don't let me hear no sniveling. Now you say, but Pastor, I don't know. Okay, but now you've got to walk in the blessings and not in the curses. Right? So now you're going to have to shift that paradigm. You're going to have to shift your way of thinking from where it was before to the Word. So now, instead of being a loser, you're a winner. You got to shift that word. You got to get that paradigm, not of the way it is, but the way you want it to be. And you're going to reach up into heaven, and just like the woman with the issue of blood, you're going to take it. Because where is the spirit realm? Where is the spirit realm? It's in the heavenly places. So how do you reach up there? With your words, because you found it. You turned on the light. And when you turned on that light, you're like, wow, I got it, I got it. You know how it hits you? But listen, if you haven't found it, then get in and search it. Get in there and find the word, and once you find it, there's so many books we can find stuff from now, it's totally ridiculous. Find it and stand on it, and no devil in hell can steal it. So she kept on saying it. Mark 5:28. For she kept saying, if I can touch the hem. Now I say, if I can find it in this word of God, I'm getting a hold of it. And I'm going to take it and I'm going to embrace it. And I'm not going to let go. And I'm not going to have to wait very long, am I? You're not going to have to wait very long, are you? Are you getting this? Say yes, Pastor. Go. So we have to reach out and get it. But guys, we got to clean up what we're saying. We got to do this here. And it says in Mark 5:29, when she got by Jesus, she found the word. Did she have to go after and find him? Say yes. She didn't sit at home like we get to sit home and just go through the Bible. But she went and she sought him out and she took it. How did she take it? She got a hold of it. Well, you know what? That was before he died and was risen. That was before the Holy Spirit was dispersed. Now we've got it. We just take it with our mouth, right? So, but what happens is too many times we get our own thinking going on. I think it should be this way. I think this is the way it really should be. No, don't give me this. Don't. I have to laugh too. Okay. How many of you turn on Fox once in a while or some of these stations and they'll say, well, I don't think Trump's making a good decision there. Anybody hear that? I hope you didn't say it yourself. If you're a billionaire and you're president-elect right now, then I'm going to listen to you. Do you know this man, God didn't put him there for fun. He put him there to do a job. And isn't that, how many weeks did he have into it and he's got more changed? The stock market is, where is the stock market? Is it down, Tom, or is it up? It's way up. This man has changed more in 3 weeks and he's not even the president's office yet. Do you get it? Well, I think he should do the... Oh, hi there, how you doing? I have to laugh. Pastor Kenny, he'll be watching the Packers and he'll say, oh, I think MacArthur should do this. Why don't you get a job as one of the coaches so you can help him? Isn't that true? Is that not what we do? Is that not what we do? See, that's what we have to stop. Because if we're so smart, and we are smart, why don't we just pray in the Spirit? Why don't we decree and declare a thing? Why don't we do that? Because we're so fooled and fouled up with the fog and smog of this world on our brains. But now, I want you to really concentrate on this. I want you to get a hold of that word of God, and I want you to hang on. Now, God says, now our memory, the devil's always, you know, I talked to somebody not too long ago. I don't remember, she's younger than me. She's, I have a hard time with my memory either. And I'm looking at her and think, And so she's talking to me, and just not the energy and blah, blah, blah. Keisha's with us, and Keisha says, well, Pastor Jana runs circles around you. She's got a good memory. Really? How do you do that? What do we sink into the what the world says. You get to be a certain age. You get to be a certain age. You shouldn't be driving anymore. You shouldn't be doing... What? What? I got until 120 years. Mary, let's go take flying lessons from Mark. We have to buy a plane together. Or we'll hire Mark and he'll fly us. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo. There you go. Tom will buy us a plane and then we'll just fly it. Hey, the light just went on. But do you see how we've got to change our thinking, people? You know, when you think of it, you think of that old crow that's on the road, that bird, the crow. What do they eat? What do they eat? The vultures eat that. They eat this, the dead stuff off the road, right? Why don't we soar with the eagles? Well, I mean, you don't want to sit down here. A car will come along and get you, wham, blood all over. I want to soar up here where I'm above. I'm soaring in the heavenlies, but I'm taking what belongs to me. But it's our mouth that gets us in trouble. So can we have a good memory to remember? Does God remember? So in Proverbs 10:7 it says, the memory of the just is blessed, but the memory of the wicked shall rot. Just think of this. The reason I bring that up is because we have a memory like Daniel. We're 10 times better. You start confessing those things. Start confessing what you want. Lynn, everybody loves me. Lori, I'm the righteousness of God. Everybody loves me. People love to be with me. Now, I'm telling the truth, because that's what God says. But if I say people don't like to be around me, I'm lying. I want to stretch into that heavenly and take what he has for me. I don't care what people say about me. I know what he says about me. He says I'm the righteousness of God. He said no good thing will he withhold from me. He said, I can have whatever I ask for. He's such a good guy, isn't he? So I want to take, I don't want to focus on the natural. Okay? I want to focus now. I'm going to do this time. I want to focus what's up above. Can you see that? Turn the lights off once. Everything. Oh, that's still not good. Okay, I want to focus on what's above, because that's where the light of the world is. You start focusing down here, and what's down here? Worldly. You focus on up here. That's where the light of the world is. And you can go up there and you can take it anytime you want. God will not withhold anything from you. Do you see that? So in Matthew 4:4, but Jesus told them, no, the scripture says, people do not live by bread alone, but by every word that cometh out of the mouth of God. I like the message. Jesus answered by quoting Deuteronomy. It takes more than bread to stay alive. It takes a steady stream of words from God's mouth. It takes a steady stream of words from God's mouth. It takes a steady stream of words from God's mouth to live in abundance to the full, to the overflow. You start going on. People come close to you and there's a fragrance and they go, ooh, they stink. But then you get somebody that says, God loves me and I love everyone. I'm the head and not the tail. I'm above and not beneath. I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the field. Oh, people are the most wonderful. I love my life. I love my home. I love my car. But it's a junker. Does it run? Love it. Love what God has already given you. Just think how awesome that is, to love what God has given you. Why do we turn on God? We would have more if we took care of it, though. Start by taking care of things with your mouth, taking care of things by your mouth. You know what? Some of these guys teach, tease us here and throw it out, that's junk. You've heard Cy say that on Duck Dynasty, oh, that's just junk. No. I don't want to throw things out to just get new. I want to repair the old. I want to, you know, if we've got something in church here and it's something that's going to make it better, absolutely. But if the old one is doing good, let's keep it. Let's paint it up. Let's take care of it. Why just get new just to get new? Right? 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 Use what you have. Or if you're going to give away what you have, then go and do whatever turns your crank. So, people do not live by bread alone. People do. When you're taking communion, in a little while, you're going to remember that. But by every word that comes from the mouth of God, this word of God right here is inspired by God. This here is from God. This is inspired by God. It's God breathed. So when you speak it, it is alive. Just like a seed that you put in the ground, it's alive and it will grow. This is a seed and it is alive and it will grow when you speak it. No, I want to do my own thing. Well, go ahead. But you're on your own, aren't you? It says in Matthew 4:4, the Message Bible, Jesus answered by quoting Deuteronomy. Listen to this. It takes more than bread to stay alive. It takes a steady stream of words from God's mouth. How about a steady stream? Did you ever see a brook that the water is running, a trout stream or anything? It's just running all the time, just running all the time. What was that place, Kim, that we'd slide down the rock up north? Slippery Rock. Slippery Rock. Thanks, Deb. Slippery Rock. You'd go over the Slippery Rock. You'd sit up on the rock and slide down, and the water was always right. Your feet would stop you on the end. That was good. You send kids down there. That's really good. You don't want to send a baby down there, though. But them little ones, they'd send them down there, and they'd hit the rock and just go up and walk again. It never stops flowing. I look at that, and I think the word of God should always be flowing out of my mouth. And the minute I want garbage, dung to come out, I'm going to stop up that flow. He says in Proverbs 4:20 through 26, my child, pay attention to what I say. Listen carefully to what my words. He wants us to listen carefully to his words. Don't lose sight of them. Let them penetrate deep into your heart. Remember, you have a wonderful memory. You can remember this. Keep your mind stayed on him. And when the devil tries to defer you off, get your mind back on because you have a good memory. Let them penetrate deep into your heart. For they bring life to those who find them and healing to their whole body. Guard your heart above all else. for it determines the course of your life. Guys, the words you're speaking determines the course of your life. You know, did you ever see people with in a shopping place and their kids just aren't in control? Did you ever hear what some of the parents are saying? Did you ever hear the garbage that's coming out of the parents' mouth? They're creating that. The kids aren't the bad ones. The parents are the bad ones. Because they got a steady stream of what? What's a steady stream? What's a steady stream? What is it? God's word. We should have our little kids. We said when Allie has kids, they'll have little uniforms on and they'll just, no. Our kids should have those uniforms on. If there, wherever you go, if there aren't rules and you just let your kids go wild, they're not going to be happy. But everybody around them is not going to be happy because there's going to be a fragrance where people will say, look at those naughty kids. Did you ever do that yourself? Did you ever go to a store? Oh, did you ever go to Walmart? Did you ever go to Walmart? Did you ever? Did you ever? Did you ever hear it sometimes? It isn't as bad now. I remember several years ago, I went, I really had to put my things away and I had to leave. I couldn't stand the kids crying. Parents were just letting their kids cry. But what they were saying back to their kids was just stirring the pot more. God says to train up our children. Well, we're supposed to be trained up so he can train us up, right? No. He's trained us up so we can train our children up. But you don't provoke your children to wrath. You don't grab them and jerk them around. You take them very nicely into your arms. You just teach them. Just love on them. That's showing the love of Christ. But if you jerk them around and you get nasty, you're not showing God to them. You're showing the devil to them. But when you take them in your arms and you just tell them, I love you, that's what Jesus does to each and every one of us. You know that, don't you? I got to tell you this here, Jaden, we were in the, I don't think you were in there, we were in the lunchroom the other day, and the Lord, I felt on my heart to go in there. And as I'm in there, I don't know what I was doing, but I was calling on the kids to give different, what did you do in there? I don't think, calling on them. And Sammy was answering. I asked for an answer, Hannah. And Jaden put her hand up, and I said, no, Hannah first. And it was Sam. No, he put his hand up first. And she got a little bit undone about that, okay, which any kid will do. And I just finished it, and I said, now you can speak. And you said, you can see she was a little bit, she was a little put out. She was going to give me that thing. But I could see she wasn't feeling the best. She just wasn't. Did you ever see that when somebody just doesn't feel the best and they just feel a little ornery? You know what ornery is, right? So I said, Lord, I don't want this little one to sit here like this. So we finished it, and I said, Jaden, I would like a piano recital. Can you do that? Sure. And we went, and she played me some songs. And I started telling her how wonderful she was. But also she learned, I can't speak over the other kids. Every one of the kids are going to try it, right? Well, she left with smiles. But God says, see, that's what I want to do with you, Jan. That's what I want you to do to other people. And she took it so well. And just brought it. But first of all, like I said, you could see she wasn't feeling the best. But she wanted to get her answer out first. Well, she's the older, so she felt she had that right too. Okay? So make a long story short, you can turn any situation around with love. With love. So he says, my child, pay attention. This is Proverbs. Pay attention to what I say. Listen carefully to my words. Don't lose sight of them. Let them penetrate deep into your heart. For they bring life to those who find them and healing to their whole body. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. What are you guarding your heart from? You're guarding your heart from speaking Deuteronomy's blessings over every situation. Don't speak the curses. Yeah, Dee Dee and Tom, I've got this in my mind right now. When you guys had the truck and it was tore curtain and you had a stop for inspection, they stopped for inspection, and Dee Dee, did you not ask or did you speak? How'd that go again? You spoke. Okay, you get quite a, they hold you back and then you get fined if something's wrong with one of the trucks. Is that true? Okay. And so Dee Dee said, am I right? She said, let's pray. We're going to agree. And what did you agree on? That they wouldn't even see it? Absolutely. They went through the inspection. Did they see it?
It was right on Tom's side. And they waved us through.
It was right on Tom's side where they could see it and they waved him through. Just keep on going. Now, would that be a pretty good fine? How long would they hold you up, Tom? Until you fix it. So you got to go get it fixed right where you are. Well, that's a piece of dirt. You know how much that costs money to hold up those big trucks. But I remember when you told me that, I could just see the curtain ripped, and I didn't see the curtain, but in my mind's eye, because when I'm talking to somebody and I want to get a vision, I got to look away and I got to get that vision. You know what I'm saying? Some of you do that too. But I got to do that. I can just see, here they are, and Tom's going, oh, we got this ripped curtain. But he's got his helpmeet there, just like he's a helpmeet to her at times. Let's pray, Tom. They don't even see it. It's right in his side. They can see it. Can they see it, Tom? They could see it as praying. How big was that rip?
Huge.
Huge. And they just waved him right through. Who covered that? Who covered that? And why did God cover it? Why did God cover it? Because of the prayers of the righteous. Availeth much. Do you see what I'm saying, people? It's what you say with your mouth. The Packers, are they going to win today, Mary? Start saying in your mouth they're going to win. Start saying what you want. Say, I got the best kids in the whole world. I've got the best husband, the best wife, the best girlfriend, the best boyfriend. Father, thank you for this body. You paid a price for this body. God told us, he said, avoid all perverse talk in verse 24. What is perverse talk? What is perverse talk? That isn't swearing. Perverse talk is when you say, well, that just can't happen. Well, that big rip in that curtain, how big? Give me a curtain rip again about how size. 10 feet? Holy man, that's bigger than I thought. 10 feet. 10 feet. Woo. And they waved you through. Did you buy her an extra gift or something because you prayed? That's a good woman you got there. Guess what? The light of the world come on right there. Prayer. A perverse word would be, oh, they're going to nail us now. We're going to have to sit here for 2 or 3 days to get this fix. That's a perverse word. Instead of saying, Father, cover it so they don't even see it. The woman with the issue of blood, she got a hold of the hem of the garment, didn't she? Did she? Have you guys been in any other fixes with your trucks like that too? Just a minute. Take it right there. Take it by you and Tom so you can both talk.
When, in fact, after we went through that, we were going down the road and the tire blew out. Then he started freaking out.
Freaking out, Tom?
They were doing an inspection that week on all these trucks. And so that they set up this makeshift place in the first place where they waved us through. Then the tire blew out. So then he didn't know if he could get down the road. So we just kept going and we got to a truck stop. Tom pulled up to the service place. They waved this truck to come in. Here they had trucks sitting over there waiting to get service that had been pulled over down the road at this makeshift for 2 hours, and they let us come right in, and they fixed the tire immediately.
Wow. Is that good or is that good?
Amen.
Tom, get a slingshot. Yeah, give that to Tom. What did you think when that happened, Tom?
Yeah, I didn't think I was going to get through it, to be honest. I thought I was going to be stranded there for a while, but it worked out good, yeah.
It worked
good
out
Lord
good.
Helped us out.
Why'd you kind of give this to Dee Dee? Because you had a prayer warrior on your hands?
He always says that. Dee Dee, you better start to pray.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, Thomas, you can pray yourself. You know what? Just think of this. Just think of this. What does it say in there? Avoid all perverse talk. Stay away from corrupt speech. That's not only from you, but from other people. If you're around people, you know, I got to say this again. When my family more or less disowned me, that was really a blessing. And I didn't realize it. But I would have been around all that perverse talk. And would I have been focusing on that more than reading the Word of God? Absolutely. When you're in a battle, you don't go hang with the crows. You fly with the eagles. Any kind of a battle in your life, watch who you hang around. Watch what you're looking at. Do you understand that? Oh, look straight ahead, verse 25. Look straight ahead and fix your eyes on what lies before you. Mark out a straight path for your feet. Stay on the safe path. Wow. What is he telling us? He's telling us, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Keep your eyes fixed. I got to say this again. Home with my parents, what did I see? I saw drinking. I saw drinking. Then as I got older, I saw more than that. So whatever we're around, we become. I became what I hated. You hang around people who drink, you're going to drink. You hang around people who smoke, you're going to smoke. You hang around people who do drugs, you're going to do drugs. You're setting yourself up to cut off the blessings, and you wonder, why is everything going wrong for me? Well, do I really have to tell you? When you cut off your blessings, it's your choice. Remember the woman with the rheumatic fever when I read that story? The woman with the rheumatic fever. She was in bed, blah, blah, blah. And she couldn't take care of her newborn baby or anything. Husband was taking care of her. And one day, what happened one day? He's reading the word. And she her mind kind of got strayed. And the light went on. He said, did you hear that? I'm strong in the Lord and in the power. What? Did you hear that? He said, say this. And she started saying it. And the light went on in her. And guess what happened? Within that same hour, she was up and walking across the room. I am strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. I'm strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. I'm strong in the Lord. Say that. I'm strong in the Lord. And in the power of his might. I am strong in the Lord. And in the power of his might. No good thing will my God withhold from me. I'm quick. I'm smart. I'm a major blessing. I win battles. I do not even have to fight. God fights them for me. I am blessed everywhere I go. I am blessed at everything I put my hand to. I have favor. I have a favor shield around me. And the first thing people come in contact with is my favor shield. Oh, yes. And I'm good looking. Now, you just look at this. You start talking. You start talking with that flow of water. But we sometimes are our own worst enemy. We speak the opposite. You know, we women get into more touchy-feely than the men sometimes. Well, you're not doing this, you're not saying that. And then instead of a man taking her into his arms and saying, do you need me just to maybe rub your feet? Do you need me just to fix dinner tonight? Do you need me just to do something for you? That's what Christ talks about, serving the church. You get it? You got it. Serve the church. But girls, don't you dare take it for granted. Don't you just, oh, he owes me. No. You get it, don't you? So now we know that we're a duplicate of God. We know that our words are powerful. So now what we're going to do is we're going to have our worship team come, and we're going to give our offering. And at the same time, right behind there, I want the communion. So now, is this the bread of life?
Yeah.
And does your mouth produce the bread of life?
Yeah.
Absolutely, we've got it. So let's do that. Let's praise and worship. And while you're doing that, you're going to sow your seed. I don't know where those little boxes are. I need them. Thank you, Father. So let's. This is our opportunity. Like I said, you have spoken over your seed. Remember, the word of God is a seed. When you speak over this seed, this produces. Oh, I don't have to give to receive. You know what? Pastor Kenny and I tithe because we're commanded to. So we're operating in the blessings. If I don't, I'm operating in the curses, but I want the blessings. But now I want to give offerings because I want the overflow. You want the overflow? Then let's do it. Let's do it, Deb. Let's hit it. Yes, amen. Glory. Your tithe and offering does. It surrounds you with the favor of the Lord. What a wonderful insurance. Ooh-wee. Is that good or is that good? So that is blessed in the name of Jesus. That is blessed. That seed is blessed in the name of Jesus because you just sang over it in Jesus' name. Now, he is the bread of life. And that bread of life, we can't live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of our mouth. Every word that comes out of our mouth. You change up and you start working the word instead of the world. and you will see increase in every area. You'll see peace, love, and joy in every area of your life. God says to focus more on his word than on the world's word. We understand, don't we? Say, I choose
to speak the word of God
over my life,
in every situation.
When that light goes on,
because I've seen the word,
I've seen that promise,
just like the woman with the issue of blood,
I'll take it by faith,
because it belongs to me,
because that is my covenant.
In Jesus' name,
let's break it and eat together.
And also, the grape juice symbolizes the Holy Spirit. We are covered with the Holy Spirit. We're the righteousness of God through the Holy Spirit. He said, we win battles we don't even have to fight. He fights them for us. He said, whatever you ask, I'll give it to you. He said, if you mess up, fess up, and I'll clean it up. And I thank you for that. And now we drink in remembrance of our covenant that we are the righteousness of God.
God is good. God is good.
He is. Please do this here. Take this word home with you. And let's see change. Let's see change. But remember, you have a perfect memory. God says you have a perfect memory. And you can draw the word to your mind anytime you want. But then you're going to do this here. You're going to turn on the light by doing what? You're going to find out what the promise of God is, and then you're going to take it by faith. And that light will stay on, and that light will produce what you have sent it out to produce. Because that's what God's word says. Do you believe that? Father God, I thank you in the precious name of Jesus. I thank you. And right now I decree and declare that everyone makes it home safely. The roads will be clear. I thank you. And also, I pray, because this flu with the stomach and so on, it's gone along too far. We stop it. We break that curse right now in the name of Jesus. We speak healing over each and every one right now in the precious name of Jesus. Do you agree? Yes. And I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. You have a wonderful day.